It is. It's still dealing with the parables and the teachings of Jesus. We are in the book of Luke today. Book of Luke, chapter number 15. We're going to be looking into three different parables that Jesus used to instruct his disciples. Now, this is when Jesus was physically there with the disciples and he was trying to teach them while they had to get it while the getting was good. Have you ever had to get while the getting was good? That means don't wait until tomorrow what you can learn, study, and get a hold of today. Don't put it off. We are going to start out over in the very first part of the chapter. We'll be going through verses 1 through 24 by the time we're finished. We have three parables. We have a parable of lost sheep, we have a parable of a lost coin, and then we have a parable of a lost son. What was the word that you heard me say three times? Lost. So this lesson is focusing on that which was lost, okay? So, finding the lost. Let's start with verses number 1 and 2. And by the way, a couple of housekeeping tips for you. We will not be having services this Wednesday. It is the day before Thanksgiving. We decided not to have a Thanksgiving dinner as a church this year. But we are having services every Sunday morning and Sunday night, just like usual. And this time of year, we do not have Wednesday night services. We have Wednesday night Christmas play practices from now until our Christmas play, which is December 21st. Okay, so put those dates down in your calendars. From now till December 21st, no Wednesday night church. It is Wednesday night Christmas play practice. And normal church services every Sunday morning, Sunday night. So please make time to come into the house of the Lord, okay? And don't forget, play practice today, 4:30. Now then, verse number 1, then drew near unto him all the publicans and sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and scribes murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. It really, to me, it comes across that they looked at it and they went, wow. You can just about picture them looking down their noses at everything coming around. You remember the Pharisees and the Sadducees, all of these very highly educated, very religious individuals sometimes weren't worth the salt and the bread. Because simply put, they thought they were better than everybody else. As a Christian, are we supposed to regard ourselves higher than everyone else? Absolutely not. How are we supposed to draw in others if we treat them awful? Have you ever walked into a church and it felt like everybody just stared you down? Did that make you want to go running back and attend that church again? Not even. Have you ever went in, you sat down, and everybody just acted like you had flown in from Mars? They just kind of gave you that look like, oh my, did you get lost? What are you doing in our church? Are you kidding me? You're supposed to be a church. You're supposed to be loving. You're supposed to be welcoming people in. We don't have time to sit here and judge them, look down our nose at them and think, oh, you smell bad. No, it's not about that. We need to be getting the people into the house of the Lord, do we not? It's not about, honey, you need to get cleaned up before you come in here. No, it's supposed to be about, honey, get in here. We need you. God needs you. It's more important to get someone saved. God will take care of the rest of it. Our job is to get them into the house. Charlie.
One thing made it even worse is the difference between having a holier than thou attitude, but they did it in religion's namesake.
They did it on behalf, they claimed on behalf of religion.
But, you know, they were speaking their God for God.
Yeah.
In the heart of hearts when they're right and they're wrong, and whether you can see it on the outside, they know on the inside who Jesus is.
Yep.
You know, and they don't need somebody, they need somebody to love them. They need somebody to take them aside.
If we don't love them in, well, people, the scripture says plainly that people will know us how. By the love that we show, because God is love. We need to realize that. Jesus, in this very first verse, was describing how all the publicans and sinners for man to see. Now, this wasn't one of his parables. This is really Jesus sitting there talking to them. And as he was talking and teaching, these lost individuals came in. You see, publicans, well, that's about the same thing as saying sinner at this time. They were hated by everybody. They were the vilest. They were just totally disregarded. And they usually disregarded others. But have you noticed, you can get the elite higher than thou, mightier than thou individuals. For example, if we had somebody from high official government sitting here, and beside them we had sitting some old motorcycle rider tattooed up, laid in the bars, whatever, for the past 15 years. And when you start teaching about the love of Jesus and what he can do, which one's going to turn to you? Usually it's going to be the person who is classified lower. Classified by society. Classified by higher ups. When in reality, the Bible teaches me that all men are created how? Equal. But somewhere along the way, we've gotten to our own minds that some are higher than others. And a lot of times, we support that in how we treat people. Charlie.
I helped get on with the church several years ago in the office. He's a big TV evangelist. And they made an announcement for the church that was started. They said, if you were sitting in the first three or four rows, you know, please leave your shoes on. You know, please be appropriate. You know, it was a show. It wasn't really a church service.
They removed the church part of it. I don't think it was Moses had a choice when he was standing on holy ground because of who might have seen his feet.
Well, and then it's also like the story of that guy that was going to be in the pastor's church. He went in one morning and put the phone off of the street. You know, when they made an announcement, nobody ever came up front. And then finally, after so many minutes, you know, no one had taken their time to welcome him as a head of them. He finally got up. They started speaking to them, you know. It's all about perception. And unfortunately, the age that we live in now, everything is based on appearance instead of what the heart says and what's.
And that's
sad. Comes out, you know, it's all about how you look, how you sound, how you smell.
That is, it's very sad.
It's really unfortunate.
And unfortunately, we do have a whole lot of Christians who are like, oh, look at me, look at what I can do. And it's all I, me. I'm sorry, but that's not God. God wants us to work equally. One thing, that's to get people saved. And in this situation, we have Jesus, and he is talking to people who are listening. Now, what's the Bible say about those who receive Jesus? Is anybody supposed to be shut out? Is anybody supposed to be, you know, close the door to them? They don't need to hear it. It says, for any who will receive, then they should be saved. Any. That word is used probably more than any of the other words in the Bible. Anyone. All who will receive. Anyone. It doesn't specify, oh, it can only be females between the ages of 15 and 20. But no, it doesn't say anything like that. We need to be accepting and loving and show people who Jesus is. Well, the Pharisees and Sadducees, they thought they already had it down pat anyway. And they started shunning these others. Well, Jesus, even from the last sermon we heard from Jimmy on Sunday night, when he was talking about who? Do you remember? I'll tell you, I'll give you a hint. He was short. He liked to hang out in trees. Yeah, Zacchaeus, he couldn't see anything. He climbed a tree, and he was the tax collector, okay? He was one of these so-called publicans. And people hated him because of that. Well, Jesus looks at him. He's like, hey, you, get down here. I'm going to your house today. Jesus going to hang out with a sinner. There is a difference with hanging out with a sinner for the time being to witness to them and hanging out with them every day of your life as your pal. Okay? Because one can rub off on the other, and a whole lot of times, unfortunately, it is easier for the sinner to rub off on the Christian than the Christian to rub off on the sinner. That's why, as Christians, we have to be very guarded on what we allow to convince us of things. We have to make sure every step and every decision lines up perfectly with the Word of God. So here, these Pharisees are like, whoop, I cannot believe. He is like, did you see that? Sharon, did you see that? That's kind of how they were going. Did you see who they were talking to? I cannot believe it. They're over there. And I've had people say things like that even about me, because a whole lot of times I had to take Leah to the doctor last week, and there was a certain individual. I've taught his kid 3 years ago, and taught his daughter. I mean, and he's a big old, he could about be a scary looking fellow if you caught him in the middle of the street at nighttime. I'd probably turn myself, but he's about yay big, has a straight head, tattooed everywhere you look at him, got piercings. I mean, he's big old burly. You see him coming, you start thinking, I wonder if there's another door I could use. Well, when I see him coming now, I'm like, hey, hey, because I started talking to him and, working with his children. And he told me, why are you nice when nobody else can treat me like that? Aren't you a Christian? Isn't that a little bit conflicting in that statement? Yes, I'm a Christian. That's why I'm nice. The Bible teaches that we are supposed to be friendly. To have friends, you got to show yourself how. Friendly. And I'm like, what are you talking about? He said, well, usually when I talk to church people, they kind of snub up and go the other way. They don't like to talk to me. They start looking at all the ink and stuff like that I've done in my life, and they don't want to talk to me. I looked at him, I said, what's that got to do with me talking to you? I said, so you had some extra money to color yourself up. I said, no, I don't agree with it. I don't support it, and you're not going to sit on me, but last time I checked, when I die, I'll answer to God for myself, and you'll answer to God for yourself. So what's that got to do with me? He looked at me and took a step back. He goes, I can find out where your church is. And to this day, he keeps saying, I'm needing to go. And now, of all things, you know how the good Lord worked it out? I taught his kid 3 years ago. So his kid's now in eighth grade. Well, now, guess who I have to have extra teaching time with every single day, according to policy set forth by the state, yada, yada. They try all these things to help the children. So help me, that young man is assigned to me every single day. We were supposed to have a change out last week and have different kids assigned. They reassigned him to my class again. And every time I talk to him, I'm like, you going to go to church with me soon? Boy, I'd like to. I keep talking to my daddy. You keep talking, son. You keep talking. The Lord will work things very interestingly. We have to be loving and accepting. Well, last week when I took Leah to the doctor's office, I go walking in, and you got, Lord, love them. A lot of people that don't necessarily have to work, they sometimes get bored, I think, and go to the doctor. They're thinking, boy, I'm bored. I'd like to talk to somebody. Who could I talk to today? Oh, yeah, I need to go to the doctor. It's like they paid to get to talk to somebody, honestly. Well, I go walking in there. I look across, sure enough, he's sitting over there at the wall. Now, he actually needed to see a doctor. But all this room is full. Well, here I am, and I was dressed in my teacher attire because I had to go to school and then leave. Well, he looked like his usual self. I go walking up. I'm like, hey, what you doing? He's like, nothing. He cleaned up the seat beside him. I just plopped down beside him. And even Leah looked at me and went, Mama? Mama, honey, have you lost your vision? Little afraid. And then I tell her who it was. She goes, oh, because she's a friend of his son's. You see, if we will befriend people, we sit there, we had a lovely conversation about weather and God and everything else. Because he knows that my main thing in life is God. And we sit there and we talk about God. And we have a lovely time of it. Because we're not supposed to be looking down our nose at people. Well, these people, though, when I go over there, sit down, and start yakking like I always do, they looked around like, oh, my. Why is she talking to him? He was totally sitting by himself. And everybody else is on the other side of the room. And I'm sitting there thinking, why do people do that? How many times have we done that? We've avoided people just because of how they look. We've separated ourselves from people. That's a chance to witness, children. And we need to take that opportunity, Mom. That's right.
He had the black little fire here. We had and CNC.
Oh, you're not about rooster.
Rooster queen.
Yes.
Well, rooster sort of got a lot of respect. And if I'm 50, some of the time, here he was, and she was back up, well, she was there, and she was a wolf on the rooster, and I'm like, man, I'm going home. And when Charleston came in here, he found where the two lives, I had any dogs on. He found out about it. And he said, man, well, you have any dogs for that? I'm going down, I'm expecting you. And I said, oh, boy, what are you doing on that one? I said, he's gone. And I said, Charleston, if you got some here, I'm just going to feel like frozen in there. When I started pulling stuff, I threw it down. But that line of the stuff for the side of the hill, and I thought, I'm not going to get a play all today. Would you believe that the 80% of those people coming out to them, help me, Booster, how are you doing? And I am on the best yard trail that day that I've ever had, you know, been alone.
Yeah.
And he, I mean, people just loved him. And I thought, and he had done the family tree three times. So I thought, oh boy.
And now when somebody like that comes along and we befriend them and they discover who Jesus is, look at the influence that goes out to others. They don't try to relegate, I guess is the word I'm looking for, who should and should not be spoken with. They talk to everybody, and they're bold enough to wait. They're going to tell everybody who Jesus is, whether they want them or not, and they're so commanding in their presence. That commanding spirit of scaring you to death changes over into, you better listen to me about Jesus, boy. And it really turns into a situation that's wonderful on the behalf of God. Charlie? That's right.
And then the person that they speak to them and know somebody in a different part of the crowd. That's kind of the way the gospel is intended to work.
That's exactly right.
They think it's a very crowd, and then one takes a very crowd, and that's the gospel.
And that's how a flame is supposed to spread. You know that, Charlie? We are supposed to let it go out and ignite those that we come in contact with. Well, when these Pharisees and Sadducees get all huffy about Jesus is talking to that sinner, Jesus comes back in verse number 3. And this is where he brings in his parable. He says, and he spake this parable unto them, saying, what man of you having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he cometh home, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep, which was lost. Understand, at that time, sheep was prosperity for these people as they lived. And they were nomadic, so that means they didn't put up fences everywhere it came. They had to have someone to stay with them. Those sheep had to have that shepherd to lead them from place to place so they could find food and water. You're talking about a desert-type region that didn't have a great amount of vegetation, so it was up to the shepherd to find them a place. So here you've got 100 sheep, and 99 of them followed the shepherd, but that one got tied up. Maybe they found a patch of grass they thought was just too good to turn loose right then. And when they were ready to go, they look up and everybody else has left them. And a sheep doesn't have a grand sense of direction or a grand sense of anything really, but they have to be led by someone. And they had nobody to lead them. So were they going to walk? Everywhere. They're not going to have one direction they're going in. They're going to walk around like they're just as lost. And when that happens in that time period, you're talking about a huge chunk of change that just walked by. Could you imagine if you get paid on a weekly basis going 1 week and somebody taking that paycheck and saying, I'll just take this for a while, and you losing it? Sure, I thought I lost the other night. I thought I lost a $20 bill. You should have seen me. I searched the people and myself. I was about to do a strip search on myself on a basketball bus on the way to our ball game because that was my money to eat on. Lord have mercy. I got a hold of the cheerleading coach. I'm like, look for my money. I got to have something to eat on. And she helped me find it. And I did find it. But we go crazy if we lose something so small. And that's what he's trying to say. What if you had lost a sheep? Well, when a person does not know Christ, that's a lost little sheep. And the shepherd, when they had found out that one was lost, he would leave the group because they'd have to stay right there. He would leave and he would go hunting until he found that lost sheep. And notice in the scripture, he didn't look at it and say, what are you doing, you dummy? You should have been with the rest of the group and take a stick and whack it. How many of us have treated situations like that? Why are you so stupid? You can't keep up with the rest of them. Get over there. Quack, quack, quack. Instead, how did he handle it? The shepherd would go over, find that sheep, pick it up, and put it where? On his shoulders. Typically, they'd have two legs here and two legs over there. They'd wrap it around their shoulders. That would be a very comfortable carry for a sheep. And that way it would be securely held in place until he got back in with the rest of the group. Lovingly, we should be bringing in those who are lost. Lovingly, we should go find them and put them around our shoulders to carry them in to a relationship with Christ. Instead, we have so many times saying, I told you so. I tried to tell you. How many times somebody say something like that to you, you just like to chop them in the throat right then? I know I would. Maybe it's just me. But somebody tells me, well, I knew that was going to happen. Immediately, I just want to go right to the throat. Just say, tell me something now. We need to be a loving individual, do we not? We're supposed to use the Bible for reproof, to reprove in love, that being the key word, Charlie.
I was wondering how many times in churches, if someone leaves, it's a little thought of in man's eyes. How many times in churches, I would have been able to speak to someone who's in the faith. If someone who's popular, they leave, you know, how many churches actually get a friend that brings you to, you know, get their better trouble.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I'm sure that happens a lot of times, you know, just because someone's
deemed important.
Yeah, they're not as important.
Yeah.
Man dies if they leave the church. You know, yeah, we'll think about it, but that means they'll pay for you too. We'll permit it to be someone who's been there for a while. It should be the same all the
time. All men are created equal. We are in God's house equally, and we need to love. In verse number 7, he follows up with, I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven over one sinner that repenteth, more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. 99 Christians, 99 of us could die and go to heaven. And that's great. But that one person that's absolutely lost and does not know Jesus, when they decide to give their life to Jesus, to accept that blood onto their lives, to become a Christian along with the rest of the family, that sparks off a party into heaven. Thank God for that 99, but thank God even more that somebody found out who Jesus is and developed that relationship. Because these 99, they have hope. What did that one fella not have? He had no hope. All he had coming to him was whatever happens, happens. But when a sinner gets saved, oh, you talk about some rejoicing in heaven. Literally, the party goes off in heaven because they know. It's just like when we have a baby born to a family down here. We get so excited. Oh, we got a new one in the family. It's going to be this, that, and the other. Well, that's kind of how God is going off in heaven. Yes, we have a new one in the family. Praise God for it. And then the angels, accordingly, they give off praise as well. And I thank God for that. When we find out that someone has gotten saved, how do we act sometimes? Boy, it's about time. I mean, have you not heard people say that? Boy, it's about time. Instead, we should look at them and say, thank God! I'm so proud of you! I'm so excited for you! Do you realize what you just set off? This was my favorite thing to do. Especially when it's somebody that totally doesn't know the scripture. I look at them and say, do you realize what you just set off? And they'll give you that look. They're like, we set something off. I'm like, you just set off the grandest party in heaven. Because the rejoicing is going on right now. All because of you. I'd like to think about that. I'd like to think about all that rejoicing going on in heaven because of me. Isn't that awesome? But we get so tied up on the inside of the church, trying to appease people, make people happy, stroke their feathers the right way. We get so distracted on the inside of the church, we hardly ever get on the outside of the church to bring somebody else in. We need to realize, we need to prioritize, we need to seize the moment for those lost souls on the outside. Because we don't have much time. We need to be busy. Charlie?
Just like the story of the prodigal son, older brother, he should have rejoiced because his brother was a prodigal son. They came back and had a party. But he was kind of jealous. It's unfortunate our prodigal son and stuff like that. It's about the second prodigal son.
Oh, wait. Stop right there. I have to stop you because I have been forbidden to speak about the prodigal son this morning out of my lesson for other reasons. I have to tell y'all this. It was so funny. Usually, well, years ago when I first started teaching this class, Jimmy was first preaching. Every sermon he practiced on me. I mean, I got it coming and going. I should be like the most grandest Christian out there. I'm really not, though. I still need a lot of prayer. But anyway, he would practice on me. Well, last night, he didn't know what, and he does not read our Sunday school lesson on purpose. He wants to be completely led by the Spirit, completely into what he's supposed to minister. So last night on the way home, he's just going over, and of all things, it's exactly what you just said. So you just started the entire thing. I'm telling on you too. I'm going to tell him, I'm going to say, hey, Charlie. I had to look at him and say, Charlie, hush! Because that's like the whole message. You're starting right there. And when I got in the car this morning, I plugged up my phone to my radio. Like I've told you, I have the Bible on my phone and I'll listen to it through the radio. I flipped it over to Luke chapter 15. I start listening. I said, hey, Jim, this is my lesson this morning. And we're talking about it. And then he heard it. Guess what story is the third parable in our lesson today? It's the prodigal son. I'm glad he wasn't driving. He'd have wrecked the car right then. He stopped. He looked at me. He said, no. I said, ooh, looks like we got the same thing. And because when I would listen to him practicing on me, every time I couldn't help myself, I'd start teaching class and out come his sermon every single time. And he'd start getting so irritated with me going, you're going to have to quit teaching my sermon before I get up there to preach it. And I'm like, I'm sorry. You shouldn't practice on me. It's good stuff. So he looks at me this morning. He said, don't you dare talk. You leave that section out. I said, I'll do what I can, but I can't make any promises. So it's not my fault now, it's yours. All right. Yeah, Grady.
Jesus said it's the example.
Mm-hmm.
And according to the commentary, this is a very controversial argument.
Absolutely. They saw him as radical.
Exactly. And I want to read some excerpts that personally I underline to me. In the introduction, what I underline was Jesus took a completely different point of view.
Mm-hmm.
In his business to reach out to them to show them the way to salvation.
and to help them find the mother father. The religious leaders took note of this and criticized the interference.
Yeah.
Okay, and over here on page 137, I underline tax collector and harlot entered the kingdom of God before the self-righteous.
Yeah.
That's from Matthew 21:31. Okay. My thing being is, Jesus was very controversial. Well, I don't know what the
Boy, that's true.
They call the people I talk to. And I really don't care. Because the people that I have talked to, you know, I've got a purpose. I've got a point. And that's why we all should. And who cares what brother and sister saw sometimes? It's all about God. So if we're in a controversial position, we're trying to say something, not much.
Jesus stayed in controversial situations trying to get someone saved. And that is where he brought, they cast a lot of blame on him. If you recall, even what led up to the very act of the crucifixion was him doing something that they didn't approve of. It started out with him healing someone on a Sabbath. And they just took it and ran with it. And with that, yes, he was being controversial on it. We need to realize a lot of people get stuck in their own ways. They get stuck in how they think it should be. Oh, it should be like this. It ought to be like this. It should be like that. And we need to realize, you know, when society changes, we need to adapt to overcome, because Jesus was meant for every single person and every single society, not just to select ones that we pick out and say, oh, well, this one's worthy and that one's worthy. No, we are all not worthy, and we are all worthy to receive salvation, because heaven wasn't just made for me, and it wasn't just made for you. It was made for every single person who would believe. And we need to push society a bit. We need to stand up for what's right. I find it very interesting on how things have changed from the time that I was a little girl up to now. Some of the terminology they use, for example, even in commercials and on television shows, the way has changed. There are some things I can still remember watching TV shows, and you never saw a man and woman that I remember asking my mom. I watched an I Love Lucy show, and I'm like, Mama, they showed something in the bedroom, and there were two twin beds. But it was the husband and wife's bedroom. I said, Mom, why do they have two twin beds in there? And she explained to me the vulgarity of showing one bed where they'd be together in the bed. Lord, look at the TV now. Now you've got non-married individuals, same-sex individuals. You got everything under the sun climbing in bed together. And it's on commercials and everything else. Look at how society has changed. With that, Christians, we need to be radical in what we stand up for. We need to be radical in supporting the Word of God. Jesus was considered a radical because he'd come out and tell them, you do need to be saved, and you do need to believe in Christ. You do need to realize the Messiah is here, and you need to live according to the Word of God. And his big thing was love. They were so wrapped up by the law. They were so wrapped up by statutes. They were so wrapped up with, well, if you stole something, we chop off your hand. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. They were so drenched and soaked to the bone with the Mosaic law that they forgot what a relationship with God was supposed to be about. And if we allow ourselves to get so drenched and soaked to the bone with what society wants, with what people want, with things out here from the material side of life, we're going to be so distracted and so busy, we're not going to realize when our relationship with God ends. Because our first thing, we got to develop a relationship with God. And that's why it's so important to find that lost person and let them know, you know what, Jesus loves you.
I think a lot of times people want to get hooked up on certain passages, you know, and use it for their own mental criticism. You know, like the passage that says, it takes and shines you by your great thing. Well, you let a certain Christian come out for what you would associate with him, or be the opposite. You know, well, how can we shun that if we're so called Christ?
True.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. But that's where you have to really depend on the Word of God to lead you in the situation you need to be in. Because He will make a way in, and He will make a way out of it. I do not believe anything about the fact that God means for us to go and hang for hours on end in a bar just so we can witness to somebody. But I believe if it is on your heart to throw somebody in there, that you need to go in and say, why don't you just come with me? Let's get out of here and separate from the situation, because that's what sanctification is, the separation of yourself, and you can apply that in just about anywhere coming and going. If I'm even sitting in the teacher's lounge at school and they start cracking nasty jokes, they really don't where I teach at, by the way. Thank God I'm surrounded by quite a good Christian group. But if they were starting to do that in a school that I did used to teach at, I had to do that more than one time when I was over in a different county teaching. More than one occasion, I would get up at lunchtime and say, well, I don't need to listen much to this, and I'd leave. And I'd go eat lunch by myself in my classroom because they would start with such a vulgar talk about themselves. There were some who appreciated drinking. There were some that appreciated sleeping around. And when they'd start talking, I'd look at them and say, guys, I don't participate in that. And I'd leave. Yes, some of those very people have sat right there on that pew with me because I've done my best to try to get them to realize who Jesus is. But at the same time, I was looked at as being different because I wouldn't stick around with it. But they had to see me every day. You see, God put me in the situation to witness to them every day. But I didn't have to take my precious 35 minutes and sit there and let them constantly saturate me and my mind and my ears with their trash talk. I separated myself from the situation. And I'd make sure to look at them and say, listen, if y'all need me, I'll just be in my room. I really don't feel like listening to this. As a Christian, we have a job that we need to stand true to. And we need to be bold enough to do it. We don't have to be hateful and rude. We need to be bold. There's a difference. A lot of people think that boldness is being hateful and rude, and I'll just tell them what I think. No, honey, that's not how it works. You see, the Bible teaches that we're supposed to talk to them in love. We're supposed to set the example that how we want to be treated. I don't want people to be hateful and rude to me. Do you want people to be hateful and rude to you? Absolutely not. As a Christian, we need to show them something different. We need to show them how loving people can be. I take great pride when a child will come into my school, and now that I'm at this school, there have been, well, there's a bunch of them I can name off situations. I'll walk in to bus duty, and a kid, Monday mornings, my favorite morning to do bus duty, and I've got it tomorrow. I'll walk in, and a kid will come flying down to me. Guess what I did? Well, I don't know. What'd you do? I got saved yesterday. And there won't even be a kid that I teach. But you know what? They know. It doesn't take us screaming it at people. It doesn't take us beating them over the head with the Bible for them to know that we're a Christian. It takes how much we show and love them. We need to realize that. If we can just get one at a time to come in, it is all worthwhile. When I became a teacher, a long time ago, good hands, Junior, good hands, proud of you. I told, there was this minister came through, a big old black feller, and I love him dearly. Well, he came through and we had a revival with him, and this was the second year he came for a revival. First year he came for a revival, God saved me. Thank God for it. I actually listened. I was 11 years old. The next year, he come through, he's praying for sick. We had a wonderful Holy Ghost-filled meeting. And God pushed me and said, go, you need to go get prayed for. So I went up to get prayed for. And he just stepped back and he looked at me and he said, wow. He said, all I see are kids. Dozens of children surround you. I was 12 years old. That freaked me out. I'll just be honest with you. I'm thinking, I ain't having that many kids. Little did I realize what God had planned for me later on. And even today, I've taught dozens and dozens and dozens of kids. And I've always told the Lord and promised Him, so long as there is one that I can touch on your behalf, I'll stay there till I die. And I can name you that one kid every single year. There's a whole lot more than one. Our newest thing right now, I lay and honestly, I dream about this at night. So I know it's God. Something so small as prayer before a basketball game. You don't realize how many people go to those basketball games. And they're ready to kill everybody in sight. It doesn't matter if your kid's only 11 years old. That's the championship. And by George's, you better know it. I'll come down there and beat you afterwards. And I'm thinking, calm yourself down, people. We're supposed to be Christian and set an example. So before every game, we always meet with the other team and we surround the center circle. You know, in a basketball court, they always have that center circle. We surround that center circle. We line it with both teams. And we open with prayer every single time. And at first, it was, what are they doing? Now, you can hear, as soon as we start walking to the center circle, everybody in the gym, they'll shh, shh, shh. And now the whole gym prays with us. We have some referees that make sure to get in the center of the circle so we can pray for them. Thank God for that. This is a public school system. And now we've got other schools posting about it on Facebook, talking about how awesome it is to have some prayer before a game. God can move in the smallest area, but He can move in a big way. We need to be able to reach. Be a radical for God. Be a little bold to get out there. And there have been some times that the coach of the team don't join us. Actually, there's only been one time, but coach of the team, he didn't join us. He goes, you go on with them girls. I don't mind them going with you. And that's the very girl that talked about it all over Facebook to get everybody else in on it. God will use. And we only got through that first parable. Thank God I got Charlie to quit. The second one, talking about that lost coin, I don't feel the need that we have to have that one. Our golden text, by the way, is over in Luke chapter 15. It's verse 10. It says, I, Jesus, say to you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. Find one sinner. It might take a day. It might take a year. It might take 10 years. But when that one comes in to know who Jesus is, what a joyous occasion that brings.